Hello viewers, welcome to CEC Gurukul Lectures. I am Dr. Sanavar Soham from Department of Botany, Kalindi College, University of Delhi, and I will be introducing you to botanical nomenclature in this part of my lecture. As we very well know, names are a means of reference to all living and non-living things. Plants have been used by man since ancient times, and plant nomenclature arose because there was the need for names which could serve as vehicles of communication. Many plants, because they are useful in some way or the other, have common names or vernacular names which are known as local names. In multilingual country like India, almost all useful plants have several local names in different languages. Even a single plant is known by several vernacular names in the same language. Not only this, but in Ayurveda, the ancient Indian literature on medicinal plants, mango, known as Mangifera indica, is known by over 50 different names, and all in Sanskrit language. Common names of plants and animals also vary from place to place. The common names obviously have a limited usage, and for wider use throughout the country or the whole world, these have proved to be unsatisfactory, since number one, they are neither universal, second, nor methodical. They may be thus misleading and inadequate. This slide shows that Quercus palustris has more than one common names. It is known as pin oak as well as Spanish swamp oak. To overcome these difficulties posed by vernacular names, the botanists have given scientific names to all known plants. The scientific names of plants are methodical and thus provide means for international communications. It was Linnaeus who for the first time proposed binomial system of nomenclature in his Species Plantarum in 1753. The first proper set of rules for nomenclature of plants was drafted by APD Candolle and passed by International Botanical Congress at Paris in 1807. During the last 100 years, the application and practice of rules necessitated many clarifications, recommendations, explanatory notes, and even changes. Now, the rules are almost stabilized. They are given in International Code of Botanical Nomenclature, also known as ICBN, which was held at St. Louis. Commonly, it is also known as St. Louis Code. If we talk of current times, International Code of Botanical Nomenclature is now known as International Code of Nomenclature for Algae, Fungi and Plants since 2011. Code helps in picking up a single correct name out of numerous scientific names available for a taxon. For cultivated plants, it is governed by International Code of Nomenclature for Cultivated Plants. With the onset of electronic revolution and the need to have common database for living organisms, for global communication in a common uniform code was being attempted. The first draft was prepared in 1995, and the draft biocode was prepared by International Committee for Bionomenclature, which was published by Grotter et al. In 1998. Another breakthrough was the development of rankless phylogenetic, which was based on the concepts of phylogenetic systematics. It omits all ranks except species and clades, based on the concept of recognition of monophyletic groups. So the development of International Code of Phylogenetic Nomenclature, which is also referred to as Phylocode, grew out of recognition that the current rank-based systems of nomenclature are not well suited to govern the names of clades. If we talk of phylogenetic nomenclature, it has several advantages over the traditional systems. First, it eliminates a major source of instability under the rank-based code changes in a clade names solely due to shifts in rank, and second, it also facilitates the naming of new clades as they are discovered. Now, I will be moving on to the principles of nomenclature. The code has certain principles, rules, and recommendations. The principles form the basis of system of nomenclature, and these are: number one, botanical nomenclature is independent of zoological nomenclature. The application of names of taxonomic group is determined by means of nomenclatural types. I will be coming to types later in this lecture. The nomenclature of a taxonomic group is based upon priority of publication. Each taxonomic group with a particular circumscription, position, and rank can bear only one correct name, the earliest that is in accordance with the rules, except in some specified cases. Scientific names of taxonomic groups are treated as Latin regardless of their derivation. The rules of nomenclature are retroactive unless expressly limited. So, moving on to the articles and recommendations of ICBN. The rules provide detailed provisions of the system and are laid out in 62 articles. The names contrary to the rules are considered illegitimate and cannot be maintained, whereas the recommendations deal with subsidiary points and are laid down for bringing uniformity and clarity. Names contrary to recommendations cannot be rejected, but definitely they are not the examples to be followed. Now, the aim of the rule of the nomenclature is one name can be rightly applied to only one taxon. One taxon should have only one correct name, but there are exceptions to this rule, and the exceptions are the names of following 9 families which have been conserved alternative names. They are Cruciferae, Guttiferae, Leguminosae, Umbelliferae, Compositae, Labiatae, Palmae, Graminae, and Papilionaceae. Now, I will discuss in detail the meaning of nomenclatural type or typification of a taxa, which is laid in the articles 7 to 10. A nomenclatural type is that constituent element of a taxon to which the name of a taxon is permanently attached, whether as a correct name or as a synonym. Different groups of plants classified for taxonomic purposes are called taxa, the basic taxon being species. Name of the families and lower taxa must be based on the nomenclatural types. The principles and articles of ICBN provide that all taxonomic groups will be based on nomenclatural types. This means that all names are permanently attached with some taxon or specimen which is designated as a type. For species, the type is a specimen or, in some circumstances, just an illustration. This is that specimen on which the species was based and originally described. Therefore, the first name given to the species by founding author is permanently attached. When a species is described, this material comprising of one or more specimens which the author has studied and on which he has concluded to have found the new species is type material. This can comprise of plants collected by one or more persons and on one or more occasions. One of these has to be labeled as holotype and others isotype and paratypes. Now I will discuss different kinds of types. So what is a holotype? It is that single specimen which may be a whole plant or a part of plant with which the name of the taxon is permanently attached. Then second is isotype, also known as co-type. These are fragments from the same plant from which the holotype was made, or plants forming of the same gathering as the holotype and bearing even the same field number are known as isotypes. The specimens other than holotype and isotype studied by the founding author at the time of describing new taxon are called paratypes. These specimens bear numbers different from the holotypes and can even be from very different localities and by different collectors as well. But they must have been studied by the author of the taxon prior to finding the new taxon. Syntypes are those specimens which were studied by the founding author and form the basis of the new taxon. But when the author did not designate any single specimen as a holotype, so if the author studies collections from different localities and by different collectors and decides to establish a new species based on them and labels all of them as types, all those specimens become syntype. If holotype, isotype, paratype, syntypes are lost or are not available, a new type is selected from other specimens to serve as a type. As the material from which the new type is selected, it is not the original type material at all. It has been suggested that the selected specimen should not be called a new type, but only as a standard specimen. Epitype is an interpretive type to serve when an established type cannot be reliably identified for the purpose of precise application of a name. An epitype is especially useful when the holotype or lectotype is an illustration from which microscopic characters cannot be seen. When no original material is available and a specimen collected from type locality is chosen to be served as type, it is called topotype. Moving on to various aspects of botanical nomenclature, first of all, I will discuss the rule of priority, which is laid in Article 11. The correct name is the earliest validly published name for the taxon. Whereas priority of publication is an important part of the rules of nomenclature and even forms one of the six principles of the code, it was realized that retrospective application of the rules of genera can sometimes result in mass scale transfer of species from one generic name to other, and consequently change of names of very many species. So to avoid this, in certain circumstances, such long usage, some names have been conserved against the valid earlier names. For the purpose of priority, certain starting points have been decided for various group of plants. For example, 1st May 1753, which is the date of Linnaeus's Species Plantarum, is taken as the starting point of spermatophytes. Publication of names of spermatophytes earlier than 1753 has no status for priority. That means they will be accepted as such. Now we move on to the next aspect, that is naming the new species. So new names are required when a new taxonomic group such as family, genus or species is founded. But under certain necessary circumstances, new names are required when new combinations are formed. When after careful study of a species, it is felt that it should be removed from one genus to another, a new name becomes necessary. I'll give you an example. Say Hemicyclia travancorica, when was transferred to Dripedes, became Dripedes travancorica. So travancorica was retained. Then when it is realized that an existing name of a plant is in contravention of the rules and is illegitimate, at that point also the new name becomes necessary. And also when a taxon has been referred at different types by different names and it is difficult to decide with certainty as to which name should be really applied to this taxon, or where a name given to a taxon has ambiguity about its legitimacy and application, to end this confusion, a new name is considered desirable and given. So for publication of new name, we must fulfill certain requirements, and the important ones are: number one, effective publication. It is done by making the printed matter available to public through its publication either in a journal or through its distribution to the libraries. Second point is valid publication. It is effected only when the following conditions are fulfilled. That is, the name must have proper form for its rank, that is the ending, for example AC for family, ALES for order. Another thing important is the name of the author and rank must be given. It must be accompanied with full or at least a diagnostic description in Latin. The nomenclatural type must be indicated for a family, the genus which is its type genus, for a genus the species which is its type species, for species or intraspecific taxon the specimen on which it is based. In case of new combinations, full length reference of base unim must be given. The date of valid publication is the date on which the effectively published material is made available. If different conditions for valid publication are fulfilled at different times, the last date is regarded as the date of valid publication of the taxon. Now moving on to next important aspect of botanical nomenclature, the legitimacy of names. To be legitimate, a name should not only be effectively and validly published, but should fulfill certain other requirements as well. It should be first validly published name for a taxon, because If there is already a validly published name for the taxon, then the second name becomes a superfluous name. Another aspect is retention and choice of names laid down in the articles 51 to 58. On transfer from one genus to another, the specific epithet is retained. Mere slight amendment of description or correction in orthography does not warrant change of name. If this amendment widens the scope of taxon, it is shown by sensu amplo, which means in wider sense, or if the circumscription reduces the scope, it is shown by the word sensu stricto, which means in a restricted sense. When we talk of rejection of names, when two or more names have been applied to a taxon, the choice for the correct name must fall on the earliest legitimate name. Superfluous names are rejected, that is, when new names are given for taxa already having legitimate names, later names are rejected. When later homonyms are rejected, that is, if the name is spelled exactly like a name previously and validly published for a taxon of the same rank based on different types, it is known as later homonym and is illegitimate. Even if the earlier homonym is illegitimate or treated as synonym on taxonomic grounds, the later homonym must be rejected. A name is rejected if it has been applied in different sense or has become a source of error or confusion. A name is also rejected if it is a tautonym, that is, when the specific epithet repeats the generic name unaltered. For example, Nasturtium is a tautonym and is illegitimate. Now, we have to understand why it is necessary sometimes to change the names. Important being, first, detection of an illegitimate name such as a tautonym, later homonym, etc. Second, as I already discussed, discovery of an earlier valid name. Third one, change in the concept of a taxon, such as merger with other taxon or splitting of one taxon into two, raising the rank of the taxon, that is status nova, or transfer of a taxon from one higher rank to another. So, we have here broadly discussed the botanical nomenclature code and some of its important aspects. I will rest my lecture here, but before that, I would like to discuss that the full text of the code provides instructions on formation of names such as gender, form, ending, application of rules, exceptions, names of hybrid, and also provisions for modification of the code. I will be discussing the citation of author in the next lecture. Thank you.